Good morning. I want to welcome everyone who is here in person today, as well as those who are at home and joining us online, either right now or later during the week. Following worship, all are cordially invited to coffee hour, and I want to make a special note that next Sunday after worship, we're having kind of an extended coffee hour covered dish. So I want to encourage you to bring something to pass, if able, and if not, that's okay. There will be plenty, and invite a friend, a neighbor, family, relative, or maybe person in the church you haven't seen in a while, but that will be next Sunday following worship. As noted, we'll be celebrating communion this morning. We'll ask you to come from the back and take the bread as our custom and dip in the cup. But if you would like the elements brought to you, just raise your hand and we'll kind of keep track, and we will gladly serve you as well. Thirdly, or last I'll say, in 2 weeks we're going to start a new members class. We have a couple of folks who want to join. We're going to gather before worship at 9:15 to 10. And talk about what it means to be in Reformed and church history. And again, there's a few folks signed up for that and want to, even if you are a member, you want to learn something new, invite you to that. Any other announcements before we begin? Well, other than Jim Benis told me that it's, you know how you have all those holidays, you know, that Hallmark has, there's one for every day of the week, right? Right? Well, but Jim Bina said today is National Pastor Spouse Appreciation Day. So, you know, I don't know. I do believe him. He's an honest, trustworthy guy. Most children of pastors are. So, most. But I just wanted to do that. Anything else?
That driving on Saturday.
Oh, yes. I'm sorry. It is noted in the bulletin.
It is.
Chick Skinner is 90 years old, and he's going to be riding 5 miles on a horse to raise money for St. Jude's. And if you would like to sponsor that, sponsor his efforts, please do. And I will say this, and I said to Chick last week, earlier in the summer, we had Jeff McElrath here. Jeff is the pastor at Alex Bay. His daughter, Althea, was born with kind of this rare form of cancer. And he would say they owe their daughter's life to St. Jude's and the treatment she received there. So I want to bring that up. With that, let us pray. Gracious, holy God, we thank you for this beautiful, beautiful day. We thank you for the beauty of creation, how it, again, reminds us of you, how it declares your glory and goodness. Help us to be mindful of our place in this world. Again, that we do have a place and a calling to be your people. Feed us today as we celebrate communion. Feed us in body and soul, that we would be strengthened in our faith, strengthened in our lives as we serve you, that we would know your presence, know your mercy, know your will, know your ways. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our opening reading is going to be Psalm 1. Psalm 1, and it is found on page 840. And I will ask you to open today, and we will read this together. And as I have said numerous times over the years, but we forget, Psalm 1 was engraved on the right pillar in the entrance to the temple in Jerusalem, and it was that important. So that when the Israelites came to worship, they would always see the words of Psalm 1 when they came to worship. So let us proclaim together God's word. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the ways of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. Amen. And let us lift our hearts and voices with hymn number 35, You Are Our God, We Are Your People. Number 35. And please rise if able.
This is the covenant he made.
And number 40. Please be seated. Responding to God's faithfulness and trust, let us confess our sins to God and to one another with the prayer that's printed in today's bulletin. Let us pray. Dear Lord, forgive us for the ways we doubt your love and forgiveness, and remain captive to our sins of the past. Help us to get past our hurts and struggles that we might find freedom in your grace. Open our hearts to your word and will so that all we say and do brings honor to you. In Christ's name and presence we pray, amen. The God who challenges us is also the God who encourages us. The God who confronts us in our sin is also the God who accepts us. Be assured that God is with us now, accepting, guiding, forgiving, and loving, and live in Christ's peace always. Amen. As we come to God's word, let us pray. Holy and timeless God, creator of all that is seen and unseen, author of life, as our Lord taught from Scripture about his death, resurrection, and ascension, may we be ascending and growing in our faith as we hear your word today. May the living Lord, may the Holy Spirit give us wisdom and insight, that our eyes may be opened and our hearts may be open to the wisdom of the word. Amen.
Our scripture readings this morning begin with Exodus 11, verses 1 to 10, and it's found on page 102 and falls under the heading, The Plague of the Firstborn. Now the Lord had said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. After that, he will let you go from here, and when he does, he will drive you out completely. Tell the people that men and women alike are to ask their neighbors for articles of silver and gold. The Lord made the Egyptians favorably disposed towards the people. And Moses himself was highly regarded in Egypt by Pharaoh's officials and by the people. So Moses said, "This is what the Lord says. About midnight, I will go throughout Egypt. Every firstborn son in Egypt will die, from the firstborn son of Pharaoh who sits on the throne to the firstborn son of the female slave who is at her handmill, and all the firstborn of the cattle as well. There will be loud wailing throughout Egypt, worse than there has ever been or ever will be. But among the Israelites, not a dog will bark at any person or animal. Then you will know that the Lord makes a distinction between Egypt and Israel. All these officials of yours will come to me, bowing down before me and saying, 'Go, you and all the people who follow you.' After that, I will leave." Then Moses, hot with anger, left Pharaoh. The Lord has said to Moses, "Pharaoh will refuse to listen to you, so that my wonders may be multiplied in Egypt." Moses and Aaron performed all these wonders before Pharaoh, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let the Israelites go out of his country.
Our gospel reading is from Luke chapter 22, verses 1 through 22. And it is found on page 1638 in the Pew Bibles. Starts with the heading, "Judas Agrees to Betray Jesus." Luke writes, "Now the festival of unleavened bread called the Passover was approaching, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some way to get rid of Jesus, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered Judas, called Iscariot, one of the 12. And Judas went to the chief priests and the officers of the temple guard and discussed with them how he might betray Jesus. They were delighted and agreed to give him money. He consented and watched for an opportunity to hand Jesus over to them when no crowd was present. Then came the day of unleavened bread, on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, 'Go and make preparations for us to eat the Passover.' 'Where do you want us to prepare it?' they asked. He replied, 'As you enter the city, a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him to the house that he enters and say to the owner of the house,' The teacher asks, 'Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, all furnished. Make preparations there." They left and found things just as Jesus had told them, so they prepared the Passover. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among you. For I tell you, I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." And he took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to the one who betrays him." Amen.
Our third reading this morning is from 1 Corinthians 10, verses 14 to 21. It's found on page 1781. Comes under the heading, "Idol Feasts and the Lord's Supper." "Therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we shall share the one loaf. Consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? Do I mean then that food sacrificed to an idol is anything, or that an idol is anything? No. But the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. Here ends our scripture lessons. Amen.
As you'll hear in the newsletter, which will go out in the middle of this week, coming up, one of the books that I've been reading this summer is called Rooted, Growing in Christ in a Rootless Age. And Stephen is a RCA pastor in Ontario, and he has served as a delegate at General Synod, and he and I have had some conversations. And it's the slow reading of this book that you'll hear about that's got questions, raised questions for me, and has served, I'll say, for kind of a prodding as we head into September. Am I alone if I say it feels as if our world, our country, and the church feels in ways like it's unraveling? No. No, I was on the phone this morning with my mom, and we're just talking, and she said, I can remember, and I'm going back to 60 years ago, roughly, because that's how old my sister is. She said she can remember going down Main Street in Hudson and hearing church bells, and all the shops were closed, and she thought about that, I don't want to say Johnny Cash song, the, what do you call it? On a Sunday morning sidewalk. Yeah, love that song. And she said, that's the way it used to be. You'd hear the bells. And things were so different. You know, I read an article, part of an article that said the rate of depression is up 400% since 1990. And there was all these factors since 1990 in the early 90s where things have just seeming to unravel. And the world almost seems unstable, right? Unstable. Things are changing more quickly than we can, you know, understand. It's like we're adrift. Who are we? What are we? Who are we? What are we? And what I want to say for us in this world where things just seem to be going every direction, the way to get back to solid ground is to be sure that we're rooted in God. The way to gain stability is to be grounded in God, grounded in God's word, to make sure we're there. And as we opened worship with Psalm 1, you know, we're here how we're to be trees. And I've written newsletter articles and preached on Psalm 1 before, but we're trees, trees planted by streams of water who bear fruit in season and whose leaves do not wither. But does it feel like we're planted by streams of water? Does it feel like at times like our leaves are withering, that the churches are withering? We're planted in good soil. We're planted in living water. We're to bear fruit even when we're stressed. And we're not meant to wither. Maybe pruned. Maybe God's got his pruning shears, but we're not to wither, no matter how severe. And as we think about that, we're planted. When we're planted, it means we have a purpose. We don't simply spring up. You know, we're not like these trees that sometimes come up in the yard or come up out in front of the cross here. You know, what do I do with those little maples? Those little maples from all the spinners. I pluck them out, you know, or I use the hoe. You know, and we you know, I don't want trees. Or when a squirrel plants a black walnut there, it's coming out. It's coming out. It's not planted there. But when something's planted, it's got a purpose. And God plants us in a particular place. God plants us with a purpose. We're, you know, wherever we are, we're not here by chance. We're not random trees. We're not random people who have just been called and gathered here. You know, we've made it and we're here. No. We have a purpose. We have a job. God has put us here where we are today. God has put us in this place at this time to witness in this world that seems so adrift, to serve him. God has called us to witness here in the community. He's called us to witness to those near and those far. And will everyone listen? I'm not talking you folks. You say, of course we are. Will everyone listen though out there? No, no. Some will, some will. And sadly, some will be like Pharaoh. Some will harden their hearts and and will just refuse. As we heard in our message today, when Moses gave that last pronouncement to Pharaoh, he left how? Hot with anger. And, you know, we don't have a lot, you know, I've not done a character study of Moses. But I think about that. Why would he be hot with anger? You know, at Pharaoh's hardness. You know, I think about the needless death, the needless pain, the needless suffering that fell upon Pharaoh's house and all of Egypt. The needless suffering on the people because they simply wouldn't listen to Moses. He wouldn't listen to God. And when we're faced with people being, you know, hardening their hearts, we can't show our anger. Right? We shouldn't anyway. But we keep on trying. We witness. We keep on being kind. We keep on showing grace. We keep on trying to love those around us like we love ourselves. And we do our best to follow Christ's example, who would, again, say, forgive them, Father. They don't know what they're doing. You know, we forgive our neighbors I don't have any neighbors who've done that. You know, but who say, get out of here. Right? No, we just be kind. And Pharaoh's hard heart cost the people of Egypt. Time and time again, it cost them their firstborn. And there was wailing that has never been as sad before or since. And that is what it took for Pharaoh to finally let the Israelites go. Now here's Bible trivia. And I'm not expecting everybody, I would like to think that most everybody know. How many plagues were there? 10? I got 10. There could be more. Plagues that God sent upon the Egyptians. The first was the blood in the Nile, where it turned and it stank and they couldn't drink. And then my favorite, the frogs. Yeah, I just think about that. Wouldn't it be fun to have like a TV movie, like a thing? You got some pastor on for TV and says something like that, and then like tens of thousands of frogs swarm the congregation. I love frogs. But you know, they would be good, right? You wouldn't mind frogs. Because frogs aren't near as bad as the gnats or the flies or the boils, the hail and the locusts. You know, imagine all those things. And then the plague of darkness. And then, again, finally, the plague of the on the death of the firstborn. It's a very sad night, a sad day. And if you recall, again, you were to, or if you left your Bibles open, and or, you know, what saved the Israelites when God passed by? The blood of the Lamb. When God came and passed by and took the firstborn, he had commanded the Israelites to eat a lamb and then put its blood on the door, placed on the sides and the tops of the Israelites' homes. And without following God's instructions, without the meal and without the blood of the lamb around the doorways, even the Israelites would be struck. That final sign, that final act freed God's people. And we call it the Passover. We just read it, right? The Passover. God passed over them and spared them, gave them their lives, gave them their freedom from the bondage of Pharaoh, freed them from slavery. And they were commanded, and this is an interesting point, they were commanded to reset time. That day, that time of the Passover was to be the first month. It reset, and they began a new year for the Israelites at that moment. So in a sense, at that first Passover, God reset all of time. God established a new beginning for the Israelites. And again, then God set down specific instructions for every Passover thereafter to follow the instructions for this meal so that the people would never, ever, ever forget how God had saved them and rescued them from death and had rescued them from the hand of Pharaoh. Now, when Jesus is baptized, John the Baptist says, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And in that same way, Jesus is referred to as the Passover lamb. We can't miss it. When we read the accounts in all the Gospels about the Last Supper, it takes place, as we heard this morning, at the Passover. Or are we to think that's coincidence? No. Is Jesus or is Jesus not our Passover lamb? He is. In the same way that God, through Moses, commanded the Israelites to never forget the Passover and never forget how they were spared from death, and to celebrate that every year, Jesus, the Passover lamb, commands us to never forget, how he has saved us, how he saved us from our sins, how he has saved us from our hard-heartedness, how he has saved us from certain death. And in Christ, just like the first Passover, which was celebrated annually, time has been reset. Reset not just for his followers, but for all the world. Because in Christ, there's a new beginning. We can't stay stuck in the past. There's a new beginning with Jesus. There's a resetting of our lives. We turn away from the past. And as we heard last week, where do we look to? We look forward to heaven in hope. We focus on the things of God in a certain future in hope, no matter how unsettling things may be for us. So as we, again, prepare our hearts this morning, I want to think ask you to think about your lives. And what are the areas that need to be reset? Where, as we come and gather, where is God calling you for a resetting, for a restarting? Because over and over again, we must. Every time we gather and celebrate the Lord's Supper, we reset our lives because we can't do it on our own. We trust in His grace, and we're strengthened to reset and do better, and to constantly do better in our walk with God, so that we open our hearts, open our minds, and open our wills to His calling. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank You for the gift of our Lord, the gift of His words, the gift of His teachings, the gift of His wisdom, the gift that we receive in Him both in this life and the next. As we will partake in Your supper, help us to remember that this is a modeling for a future with You, with all saints from all generations, in the feast of heaven. Amen. Our song of response is 807, All Who Are Thirsty, and you may remain seated, number 807. And turning to 810, lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right for us to give thanks and praise.
With joy we praise You, gracious God, for You have created heaven and earth, made us in Your image, and kept covenant with us, even when we fell into sin. We give You thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, who by his life, death, and resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we join our voices with all the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to God the Father that our Savior, Jesus Christ, before he suffered, gave us this memorial of his sacrifice until he comes again. At his last supper, the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after the supper and said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The blood of our Lord shed for the sins of the world. We proclaim our faith as signed and sealed in this sacrament. Lord our God, send your Holy Spirit so that this bread and cup may be for us the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. May we and all your saints be united with Christ and remain faithful in hope and love. Gather your whole church, O Lord, into the glory of your kingdom. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the children of God. Come, for all things are now ready. As our Lord has fed us at his table, our offertory this morning is let us break bread together, and may you use this time for prayers of supplication and thanksgiving. Let us pray. By your love, O Lord God, we're called to new obedience. Bless you. In honor of our commitment to Christ, we give our gifts to you. We give our lives to you. Help us to make our giving complete by offering ourselves fully to you. Grant us this blessing in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for times of refreshment, and we thank you for this summer. Thank you for, again, this Labor Day weekend, when we can reflect on the meaning of work, knowing that your word tells us that finding satisfaction in your work, in our work, is a gift. Help us to find that. We give you thanks for teachers and students, and we lift up to you the students and teachers in our local schools. Give them wisdom and guidance. May they truly know what they say and do matters in children's lives. Be with families, strengthen them, hold them together in bonds that are not to be broken. We give you thanks for healing for Jackie and ask for continued healing. Be with Donna Tallman, her treatments, that you would find your grace. Be with Lisa, and we ask that you watch over her, give her, again, encouragement and strength in her rehab. Be with Katie, watch over her and her family. May they know they are loved. Be with Jerry. Give him, again, thank you for his last treatment and that he would find healing. Be with those that are confined to nursing homes at this time. May they know they are not forgotten, but cared for and loved. We lift up to you those going through the valley of the shadow of death. We lift up to you those struck with the fires in Hawaii, hurricane in Florida, and the violence in Europe and the Ukraine. We lift up to you the family of Bob Luther and ask that you would again show them your comfort, show them your grace. We take a moment to lift up to you the concerns and the joys that are held in our hearts but known by you. And together we pray the prayer you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our sending song this morning is number 936, Sent Forth by God's Blessing, number 936. And I would ask if you would please rise, if able.
This dwelling, take leave. The supper is
go in the name and the love of Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.